Well, right now it's my pleasure to introduce a very special guest we have with us today, and her name is Anne Korin, and she is the co-director of the Institute of the Analysis of Global Security. And she also is chairperson of the Set America Free Coalition, which is kind of an interesting alliance of different folks, national security, environment, labor, and religious groups that are promoting ways to reduce oil's strategic importance by breaking its monopoly over transportation fuel. I think that's something we can all agree with here. She appears in the media frequently and has written articles for several important publications, including Foreign Affairs, The American Interest, National Review, The American Legion magazine, and the Journal of International Security Affairs. And something I'm sure she'll talk quite a bit about today, she's co-author of a book called Turning Oil into Salt, Energy Independence Through Fuel Choice. And I think that's a message that we all will find very interesting, and it will really resonate with a lot of the things we've talked about here today. So please help me give a warm welcome to Ms. Anne Korin.
You know, if you'll indulge me, I'm going to start by reading a very short quote from our book, because over the past few years, I've thought a great deal about the decline and fall of the Roman Empire. And it wasn't swift, it was a gradual process. But I think we need to think about it. You heard today about the legislation that Congress passed essentially to mandate digital televisions. And to me, that really resonated with the concept of bread and circuses, because if you're willing to focus on that and not willing to focus on the key things we need to do to break oil's hold over our economy, when every time oil prices spike, our economy bleeds and it sends us into an economic decline, never mind all the national security impacts, then we have a serious problem with our leadership. So what I want to read you is a statement that the Roman poet Juvenal made during the decline of the Roman Empire. For the people who once upon a time handed out military command, high civil office, legions, everything now restrains itself and anxiously hopes for just two things, bread and circuses. And I really, really hope that that's not where we're headed. But to ensure that that's not where we're headed, we're going to have to change the focus of our leadership. And in order to change the focus of our leadership, we need to make it clear what the problems are that we're trying to solve. And I think when it comes to energy, there's a great deal of confusion in Congress about what the problem is that needs to be solved. First of all, the national security issues that relate to energy in the United States really relate to oil, because 3/4 of world oil reserves are in countries in which radical Islam is on the rise, because 78% of world oil reserves are controlled by the cartel, by OPEC, and that's Saudi Arabia and Iran and Venezuela and other, you know, nice and friendly countries that share our values. And at the same time, we're engaged in a war that radical Islam has declared against us. And it's very unlikely that we're going to win this war as long as we keep funding both sides. Because, of course, if you look at the economy of the major sponsors of radical Islam, if you're looking at radical Sunni Islam, the major funder and propagator of that is Saudi Arabia, which sits on 1/4 of the world's oil reserves. It's one family that controls 1/4 of the world's oil reserves. You know, think back to the Spanish Inquisition and imagine that Torquemada was sitting on 1/4 of the world's most strategic commodity. That's where we are. Think about the biggest sponsor and propagator of radical Shia Islam, that's Iran. Again, major oil reserve holder. So I don't need to tell you this, you know all of this. But the point is that when it comes to oil, the national and economic security vulnerabilities that we face do not stem from our level of consumption. This may be counterintuitive. They do not stem from our level of consumption, and they don't even stem from our level of imports. They stem from the fact that oil is a strategic commodity. And to understand this, you need to look to history. That's why we titled our book, Turning Oil into Salt. Because salt was once a strategic commodity. Wars were fought over salt. Countries chose, in some cases, where to place colonies because of where there was an abundance of salt, because it was the only way to preserve food. It was the only way to preserve food. So salt really determined the course of history. It was extremely important. The word salary comes from salt. Soldiers used to be paid with salt. This seems ridiculous to you today, but salt was as important then as oil is now. Well, what happened? One day Napoleon had enough. Armies, of course, march on their stomach, and he wanted to make sure he could march thousands of miles without having to rely on this commodity. And so he set a prize of 12,000 francs for whoever could make salt irrelevant. And it took 10 years, and a French chef developed the earliest form of canning, which was preserving food in bottles. Then came canning as we know it. Later came electricity, and with it, refrigeration. Well, we consume more salt now than we ever did before, but does anybody here know who the world's salt reserve holders are? Does anyone know whether we import any salt? How much salt we import? Do you care? You don't care. That's what energy independence means. Okay, energy independence means turning oil from a strategic commodity, as salt once was, to just another commodity, as salt is today. And just as salt's strategic value derived from its monopoly over food preservation, oil's status as a strategic commodity derives from its monopoly over transportation fuel. And here we see a great deal of confusion in Congress, because I'm sure that, like me, you've heard, whether on the Democratic side or on the Republican side, you've heard politicians running for election saying things like, if we only build more solar panels and wind turbines or nuclear power plants, you know, we're going to drastically reduce our dependence on oil, right? You've heard this. But the fact is, as I'm sure you know, we essentially no longer generate electricity from oil in this country. Only 2% of U.S. electricity is generated from oil. And whenever, conversely, only 2% of our oil demand is due to electricity generation. And the same situation globally. So whenever a politician offers to the public solar, wind, nuclear, whatever the value, and there is a value to these technologies and these energy sources, whenever they offer this as a solution to our dependence on oil, it's confusing the public and taking the focus away from transportation. We cannot let this stand. We have to call them on it every single time they do it. The second thing that happens, and the push to writing this book came during the 2008 elections. Because the second thing that happened was, aside from talking about solutions that are completely irrelevant, our politicians focus on solutions that are completely tactical, not strategic. You know, Band-Aids to somebody who's having a heart attack or a stroke. So what's an example of that? Well, think back to the 2008 elections. On the right, we had drill, baby, drill. And on the left, we had Americans are consuming too much. They need to drive smaller cars. You know, we need either increased fuel efficiency standards or gas taxes or whatever. In the punditry, not just, no politician would call for a gas tax, but in the punditry. Now, there's nothing wrong with expanding domestic drilling. Efficiency is certainly great. But the fact is, these are essentially useless tactics when it comes to energy independence. And the reason is that we are facing a cartel. Now, this cartel, again, sits on over 3/4 of world oil reserves, but only accounts for 40% of world oil supply. And we need to think about how this cartel responds to various policies and tactics to see if they would have any relevance whatsoever. 35 years ago, 37 now actually, during the Arab oil embargo, OPEC produced around 30 million barrels of oil a day. You know how much they produce today? Okay? In the meantime, global demand for oil drastically increased. Non-OPEC production drastically increased. But OPEC produces less than it did 37 years ago. Now let's talk about what OPEC does when we drill more or when we use less. Well, oil went to $147 a barrel, right? Prices at the pump went to $5 a gallon. Consumers are perfectly rational. What did they do? We all drove less, right? We dropped our gasoline consumption by 10%. Our oil consumption in the U.S. dropped by about a million barrels a day. Same thing elsewhere around the world. What did OPEC do in response? That's right. They met several times over the course of 6 months, and they cut production by 4 million barrels a day. They cheat, so their effective production cut was closer to 3, but they cut production. We used less, they drilled less, in order to drive prices back up as inventories eroded. And you can think of our using less as a proxy for lots of things. You know, we dropped gasoline consumption by 10%. You can think of that as a proxy for increasing fuel efficiency standards across the board, even in existing cars on the road, by 10% overnight. Okay, it's not an exact proxy because it doesn't continue the effect, but it allows you to see how OPEC would respond. You can think about $5 at the pump as a proxy for a $3 a gallon gas tax. You're not paying it to Uncle Sam, you're paying it to Uncle Saud or Uncle Hugo, but you're paying a gas tax. Okay, so you can see how OPEC would respond to that. So that's using less. But using less is exactly the same as drilling more from OPEC's perspective. Again, look at the history of the last 37 years. Every time non-OPEC countries have increased production, what has OPEC done? It's dropped production. It's not a one-to-one relationship because at the same time you have the rise of the developing world. And lots of people, hundreds of millions of people, slowly rising out of poverty in China and India and shifting from bicycles to cars. So you have this increase in consumption. But nonetheless, if there's a net increase in production, OPEC reduces supply to drive prices up. And so what we realize from this is that the same old tactics are not going to work to change the playing field. As long as oil is the currency, OPEC is literally in the driver's seat. And so we need to open the market to fuel competition. Now, you all are a very important part of this, as you're well aware. But let's talk about specifically what can be done to open the market to fuel competition. Because opening the market to fuel competition has to start with the cars. Vehicles have to be platforms on which fuels can compete. And there's near, mid, and long-term ways to think about this. Near-term, the easiest thing to do is liquid fuel competition. I've heard you all talk about flex fuel vehicles. But we can't just think about gasoline ethanol vehicles. And I'm going to talk to you here from a political perspective. When I think about the politics of all this, okay? When I think about the politics of all this, I put the numbers together as follows. I think about the number of senators from agricultural states. I think about the number of senators from states that produce coal. I think about the number of senators from states that produce natural gas. And I think that if we put that group together, that's an undefeatable coalition. An undefeatable coalition, and the same thing in the House. And if you talk about flex fuel vehicles, and you talk about an open fuel standard, which means every new car sold in this country has to be a gasoline, ethanol, methanol flex fuel vehicle, which is essentially the same as a gasoline, ethanol flex fuel vehicle with a slight tweak to the chip and slightly higher grade materials in the fuel line, then what you've done is all of a sudden this isn't just a farm issue. You heard range fuel. Methanol you can certainly make from cellulosic biomass, but you can also make it from coal and natural gas. And when you start to think about the politics of getting flex fuel vehicles in place, here's what you have to think about. Senator Brownback, who was supposed to speak here today, along with Senator Cantwell and Klobuchar and Thune and Grassley and Collins and Lieberman, introduced a bill called Open Fuel Standard that would essentially do this. That bill, any flex fuel vehicle bill, gets referred to the Commerce Committee in the Senate. Who chairs the Commerce Committee in the Senate? Senator Rockefeller. What state is he from? West Virginia. Are they growing corn in West Virginia? No. Who's the ranking member in the Commerce Committee in the Senate? Senator Hutchinson from Texas. Does she like ethanol? No, but she likes natural gas. Most of the methanol in the world is made from natural gas. China's making a heck of a lot of methanol from coal. If you start to put these groups together, all American producers of fuel, all American producers of energy, it's very, very hard to argue against that kind of political clout. It's very, very hard to argue against people that are saying, we want an open and competitive market when it comes to transportation fuel. And when you go to the pump, you choose what you want to put in your tank. And if you're in Kentucky, maybe that's something different than if you're in Iowa, or Kansas, or Hawaii. But you should have the right to choose. Because the fact is, when oil went to $147 a barrel, you all know, ethanol, methanol, all the liquids were competitive and economic at less than half that, right? How did we get to $147 a barrel? We have to explain to the public. It's as if you're lactose intolerant. You're lactose intolerant, but you have to start your day with a cup of coffee. If soy milk goes to $50 a gallon, are you going to be able to put cow milk in your coffee? No. So our cars are lactose intolerant. You know, oil can go to $300. What can we do? Nothing. Use less, drive less, constrict our lives. We need to be able to choose. We need to be able to choose just as consumers in Brazil choose. We see how this works. We can give that example. We know the consumers in Brazil chose. We know that in 2008, gasoline became an alternative fuel in Brazil. Wouldn't it have become an alternative fuel in the United States? If only producers had an incentive to expand capacity, if only they weren't facing a blend wall, if only vehicles actually enabled there to be a market. You know, near-term liquid fuel choice, it's very, very doable. And it integrates very well with mid and long-term options like electrification of transportation. Because if you think 20 years down the road, you want new cars to be flex fuel plug-in hybrids, right? So you can choose a variety of liquid fuels, or you can choose to plug in your car. Whatever it is that you want to do, you can choose to do. All of these groups, all of these fuels need to be working together. But the first step, to my mind, is an open fuel standard. An open fuel standard. And I'm going to ask you this. How many people here are from Missouri? You know, your Senator McCaskill is on the Commerce Committee. She's not a co-sponsor of the Open Fuel Standard. Might be interesting for her to hear what people think about it. Is anyone here from Georgia? The Range Fuels was here before, but no. You know, Isaacson and Chambliss aren't co-sponsors. They may say they don't support mandates, but did they vote for the Renewable Fuel Standard? That's a mandate, right? Did they vote for increasing fuel efficiency standards? That's a mandate. Did they vote for digital television? That's a mandate. You know, we can go state after state and pick on senator after senator. And the same in the House. The fact is that if we don't call them on it, we don't focus them on what specifically needs to be done, they're not going to do it. They're perfectly happy to wave around their speeches on energy independence and come to us year after year to raise more money and not accomplish anything. So we have to focus their attention on this. Because what's going to happen, and there's no doubt in my mind, if we don't open our fuel market to competition, what's going to happen is that as we emerge from this recession and oil consumption grows, and it's already been growing gangbusters in developing Asia, as we emerge from this recession and oil consumption grows, what's going to happen to price? It's going to go up because we have increased demand, we have a cartel that's constraining supply. Even if we don't talk about the jihadist attacks against oil infrastructure and efforts to disrupt the oil market in order to hurt the United States and other countries, even if we don't talk about that, we're going to have a spike in oil prices. We're going to go back to three-digit oil. There's no doubt in my mind. And when we go back to three-digit oil, what's going to happen to our economy? It's going to go right back down into a decline. And so instead of seeing a recovery, a V-shaped recovery, we're going to have a series of W's. Because every time we emerge, oil price is going to slap us right back down into the hole. And that's why I started this talk with the decline and fall of the Roman Empire. Because if you think about it, this is the second largest household expense, right? It's not just the fuel that people pay for at the gas station. It's the food they buy. It's the clothes they buy. Everything we buy has an energy component to its price, has an oil component to its price, because it has to be transported and brought to us. So spike in oil prices affects our entire economy. A spike in oil prices sends enormous amounts of money overseas. You've already heard the statistics today. I don't have to recite them again for you. But the fact is, until we institute this cheap insurance policy, until we break the monopoly of oil over transportation fuel, we are at the mercy of countries that hate us and will do everything in their power to weaken us, and have already done a pretty damn good job. That's all I have to tell you. I'll be glad to take any questions that you may have. And thank you for all that you do. And please fight for the open fuel standard. This is something that's politically achievable, and it would make a huge difference for this country. Thank you.
For more Press Pass coverage of all major automotive events, visit theautochannel.com, the internet's most complete and comprehensive automotive information resource.